Finally tonight, some advance words on this special series of reports on autism that will start Monday here on the NewsHour. The correspondent is a very familiar one, Robert MacNeil, reporting for us for the first time in over a decade. His six stories called Autism Now are a comprehensive look at its impact and prevalence, as well as the latest on research. I spoke with Robin from New York earlier today. Robin, welcome.
Thank you. You're good to do this.
Look, your interest in autism began as a personal interest, did it not?
That's right. 4 years ago, my grandson Nick, Allison's son, was diagnosed with autism at the age of two. He's now six. And when I've learned since that when any family has a member with autism, the whole family tends to revolve around that condition. It so permeates every aspect of their lives that in many conversations with Allison over the years, I felt more and more inclined that I just had to do something about this, what I could learn about it, and to help draw more attention to the condition. The committee of the National Institute for Mental Health recently called this a national health emergency.
Wow.
And the more people know about it, the better.
Sure. Well, look, we have an excerpt from the very first of the reports. It's going to run on Monday, which tells just a scrap of the story about you and Nick. Here, let's look at that.
This was Nick when he was 9 months old, a healthy, alert, and engaged baby with no apparent medical problems. Now at six, my grandson seems like a different child, showing the classic symptoms of autism, a disorder in development. His difficulty connecting.
Can I read that one for you? Do you want to look at it yourselves?
Nick struggles with language. The rigidity and resistance to change Nick shares with other children with autism.
Now go home.
Yeah, we'll go home and walk this way.
A tendency to suddenly appear absent, to withdraw into an emotionally detached inner world of his own. Those symptoms are characteristic of the autism spectrum, severe to mild, in Nick's case, relatively mild. But beyond such mental difficulties, Nick has serious physical illness in his digestive system. His mitochondria, the energy needed by his cells for normal activity, plus frequent small brain seizures and extreme sensitivity to light and sound.
So, Robin, is there an exact definition of what autism is, at least an accepted definition?
Well, it's a good question. There is a definition published in the manual that people in the mental health business use to describe it. And I've just mentioned some of the symptoms.
Sure.
It's a difficulty connecting, a difficulty with language, a difficulty empathizing with other human beings, and a remoteness about it. Plus, in his particular case, which is why not only because he's my grandson we're putting him first, but because he represents a wider concept of autism now, that it can be accompanied by all these physical conditions.
Yeah. What is known about the cause, of not only in Nick's case, but in all cases?
It's still quite a mystery, but that is the subject of our third report on Wednesday night. We've talked to the latest people doing the latest research, and they're finding it an increasingly complex condition. They thought a few years ago that they were going to find a simple genetic clue. They haven't. They're finding many, many genes and possibly many things in the environment today added to a genetic predisposition which could trigger the neurodevelopment effects of this. So it's still some years from finding the cause.
So that means there's no cure, there's no treatment?
Well, there are forms of treatment now. I mean, there is some drug treatment for people with seizures, for example. Mm-hmm. And if you can afford it, or the school system can afford it, one-on-one individual education can help relieve some of the social symptoms of autism and draw these young people away from it, especially if caught very young. But as far as everybody knows now, most people know now, it is a lifelong condition, mild or severe, and many of these people will need assistance for all their lives.
Now, when you said use the word emergency a moment ago, does that mean this is growing, or what is the how widespread is it among Americans?
It now represents about 1% of American children, 1 in 110. But the head of the National Institute, who's on our last program, said he feels that it is still growing. There's some disagreement about the rate of growth. Some people feel it's because they've widened the definition of autism to include things that used to be called things like retardation. But others say, no, that only explains part of the increase. And it is, some people want it called an epidemic. But that suggests another kind of medical condition than this. It is, nevertheless, a very interesting, complex, frustrating, and for the families, not only heart-rending, but demanding of them in looking after these children, an extent of love and patience and attention that is really extraordinary.
What's the principal focus of the research right now, of trying to find out exactly what happens and why and what can be done about it?
It is, as our program on Wednesday night will show, it's both genetic. They thought they would find a simple genetic cause. They have not. And they're looking both at, more increasingly, at environmental factors. You know, we've added a lot of substances to our environments in the last few generations. And those, together with genetic, some form of genetic predisposition or susceptibility, is where they expect to find not one cause, but combinations of causes that may be very complex.
Okay. Well, Robin, we look forward to all six pieces that begin on Monday and salute you for doing this.
Well, thank you. See you then.
You bet.
And you can already watch the first story in Robin's series in its entirety on our website. It is part of much more coverage online that complements our broadcast stories. You'll be able to see Robin's stories the night before they appear here on the program. The site also features information about dealing with costs, with insurance coverage, and resources for autism. You can provide your feedback via email, Facebook, Twitter, and even by phone. And when the series is over, Robin will respond to viewer questions. It's all on our special Autism Now page.